The Club Championship Show on OTB Sports in partnership with AIB, proud sponsors of the Football, Hurling and Camogie All-Ireland Club Championships. Hashtag the toughest.
Welcome along to the Club Championship Show here on OTB Sports, brought to you by AIB. Coming up over the next 40 minutes or so, Ballygunner bring out the big artillery to blitz Kilmallock in the Munster Club Hurling Final. No Paul Mannion, no problem for Kilmacook Crokes as they see off Naas in the Leinster Club Football Decider. Pádraic Pearces are celebrating their first ever Connacht title. And there was some vengeance for both St. Rinus and Raharney as they put their 2019 final defeats behind them in the weekend's All-Ireland Camogie Finals. We'll also be looking forward to both the Munster Football Final and the Ulster Football Final, which are on this weekend. We'll be talking to Fintan O'Toole and Cahair O'Kane over the next 40 minutes. But delighted to say that Killian Whelan is with me. Killian, how are you getting on?
Good, Will. How are you?
Yeah, I mean, this is a great week because we get a chance to look back on the three provincial finals from last weekend, a couple of Camogie finals, which were played 22 months after the championships had been concluded for the 2019 season. And we've also got a chance to look forward to some excellent games coming up this weekend. We'll talk about the Camogie in a bit more detail later on. I know you were covering the Raharney against Clonmorris game at the weekend. Just so many kind of remarkable stories, though, which we can tease out, including the fact that, you know, Clonmorris going into that game just had 17 players, Killian, and yet they were able to battle their way to an All-Ireland final and push Raharney all the way.
Yeah, they're a unique group. There's no doubt about that, Will. From, you know, the experience of Clonmorris and Kerry Camogie in recent years, you know, they have been the backbone of getting the game and keeping the game alive down there. And to now, to such an extent that it looks like there's going to be a four-team senior championship in Kerry next year. And that's all, no question about it, down to the efforts of the club of Clonmorris. What that means for Clonmorris for the future, I don't know, because obviously there's a, you know, any young player now coming through, you know, they're probably going in different directions to some of the other clubs. So, but look, Clonmorris, they're alive and kicking still. Liz Houlihan, she is to give birth in the next few weeks, and yet she was still on the sideline wearing the number 16 jersey, willing to step over the line if it meant that you know, they had to have a certain amount of players on the field in the semi-final, and she was willing to do the same again the last day. It's a unique story in lots of ways. Probably, you know, through no fault of their own, with everything going on with COVID and stuff, that the registration fell through the cracks, I think, with one or two of the players who had went away, and I think there was another pregnancy in the camp and so forth. But look, They fought on, and it just goes to show you their whole element as a group about what they are able to do, and what and the belief that they have in each other, that they were still able to compete, and rightly compete right up the end in an All-Ireland final.
Yeah, two good deciders last weekend. Let's have a look then at the results from the weekend just gone by in the AIB Championships. It was a busy one. Provincial finals across the board. We had the Munster Hurling Final, where Ballygunner were so impressive. Desi Hutchinson would 1-5 as they beat Kilmallock by 3 goals and 20 points to 1 goal and 12. So Ballygunner winning their second title in recent years, backing up their championship victory from 2018. We had two football deciders which were played in the weekend just gone by. On Saturday, Kilmacook Crokes keeping Naas quiet for 30 minutes without a score as they won their fifth Leinster title, 14 points to 7 at Croke Park. And then we had a dramatic end to the Connacht football final, where Knockmore of Mayo will look back at the 14 wides they had in the second half, but Pádraic Pearces scoring from a penalty early in the game and holding on for victory, a win for Pat Flanagan's side by 2 points, 113 to 111 in Ballina. So history made for Pádraic Pearces. Time for have a look at the hurling final, which is at Páirce Caoimh on Sunday afternoon. Delighted to say that Fintan O'Toole from the 42.ie is with us. And Fintan, when it comes to performances that we've seen, like as impressive as Ballyhale Shamrocks were against Cluck Ballacolla just before Christmas, this was a real marker laid down by Ballycunner on Sunday afternoon. They were so, so good.
Absolutely, Will. Yeah, it was a real kind of statement of intent. I think summed up by the scoring stats that they put up, you know, like, generally, Munster club finals over the last couple of years have been pretty well contested. I mean, the only thing really comparable to this was what Napiershig did in 2013 against Six Mile Bridge, doing that by 18 points. And as this game headed into injury time, Ballygunner were up by that same margin, and then they conceded the 1-1. But yeah, right from the start, they were really on it. You know, I suppose just the moment that Desi Hutchinson got the goal, and then like there were 6 points clear by the first quarter, then the two goals right in the third quarter, to really kind of put the game to bed. And like, for a game that I'd say a lot of neutrals were kind of looking forward to, it ended up being far more one-sided. But from a Ballygunner point of view, it gives them a serious bounce now going into the All-Ireland series. And the fact that that's only in 2 weeks' time, I think, is going to be of a benefit to them, that it isn't the usual kind of traditional thing they would have been used to when they previously won in 2018. They are waiting 2.5 months probably for your All-Ireland club semi-final. And with the form that they showed on Sunday in Páirc Uí Chaoimh, they're going to be heading into that with a lot of confidence.
That could be an important factor, yeah, because we were talking to Chrissy McCaig just before Christmas, and they were delighted if their Ulster final played before Christmas and they could maybe have that off their mind and then do a bit of work in January to be ready for the semi-final. But it's clear that Ballygunner are in a much sharper place now going into that game in 2 weeks than anyway Sloughneil possibly could be, having not played a game for a month competitively.
Absolutely. And like it's a very difficult thing if you talk to different clubs over the last couple of years that have had to manage that gap in terms of trying to get challenge matches. You know, they're trying to play against teams maybe in Fitzgibbon or Sigerson and whatever code is applicable, or maybe a team that's in an intermediate or in a semi-final. But it is quite tricky to get these games. But the way the schedule has fallen for Ballygunner now, I think is really kind of nice. The way that they had that Munster semi-final, the really tough one, I suppose, on the 12th of December against Loughmore Castellaney, where it was kind of park that, kind of have Christmas, kind of get set for this game on the 9th of January. And obviously they got the preparation spot on with how they kind of hit the ground running on Sunday. And look, just, I suppose, look, they're such an experienced side in terms of the amount of Munster club campaigns they've been in. They've obviously been dominating the Waterford Championship, but there's definitely, you get a sense of a real ambition to kick on now. They would have been quite disappointed with their record in Munster over the last couple of years, considering they did 8 in a row in Waterford. And this was only the second Munster title that this group managed to achieve. So it was a big thing, I think, for them. You know, they've, like, no club has lost more Munster club finals than them. And some of these players, like as Philip Manny was saying afterwards, he had lost 4. So I think for a lot of them to win that second, it's just a real kind of sense of satisfaction. And then I suppose that's the provincial kind of part of the job now kind of done. And now it's about trying to kick on in the All-Ireland series, because the club have been in 2 semi-finals before but haven't made it to a final. So that's a big, I think, goal for this team, to try and get to Croke Park.
And Fintan, they kind of a combination of a team here too. Like Páirc Manny was on after he got the man of the match after his 8 points of the weekend. And TG Carr were asking about that, whether the pain of, you know, not having won a title since 2018 and having been to 4 finals and only won one of them previously. And he was very quick to point out that there's quite a few players on their panel right now who weren't around when they won their last provincial. There's been a lot of new blood brought in over the last couple of years. So while there's the spine of the Mahonies and, you know, O'Keefe in goal, they also have a few young players coming into that team at the same time.
Definitely, and like that really stood out. Like I was taking a look at it, like when they beat Napiershig in 2018 to win the Munster final, only 8 of the players that started that game started last Sunday. And of the 7 new players, only Mikey Manny actually came on in that game in 2018. So that's a sizable amount of turnover. So like basically what's happened is that you've a lot of very good young players. Like they're going to be dominating Waterford club championships at kind of minor 21 level for the last couple of years. There's guys like Ty Foley, Ronan Power, Paddy Levy, Kevin Manny. They've all been on Waterford under 20 sides the last couple of years. So they've been really, really big additions, really, really good players, really kind of bolstering the strength of the squad. But the absolute game changer has been the return of Desi Hutchinson. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's quite remarkable to think that when the 2019 season started, he hadn't played a game of hurling in 6 years, obviously between being over in England with Brighton and then obviously playing the League of Ireland with Waterford when he came back first. And then he was actually playing with the Waterford footballers initially as well. But the level of hurling that he's serving up, I mean, everyone's seen it at a county level, but I think that it's just elevating Ballygunner. And like we've seen with, say, Ballyhale over the last couple of years, you know, obviously TJ Reid and then Colin Fenley and now Owen Cody and Adrian Mullen, you need to have those real top class kind of 9 out of 10 forwards. And like Desi was just a joy to watch on Sunday. You know, the goal he got in the first couple of minutes, some of the points he got. And in fairness, the Ballygunner style of play is a huge thing in terms of, there's kind of traits of it, kind of reminds you a bit of Limerick in terms of like every ball goes to hand coming out of the defence. There's loads of different runners off the shoulder. But then when they get to that midfield, like there was one of Desi's points, Hutchinson's points just after half time kind of summed it up, or sorry, just before half time, where basically Kilmarnock had possession on a sideline and Ballygunner turned them over, broke quickly. And I think it was Conor Sheehan and Paulie Mahoney played a 1-2, and then the ball was fed into Hutchinson who put it over. So he definitely has been, I think, the biggest addition and probably kind of taking them to another level from where they would have been in 2018.
And having that goal threat so important as well. 3 games now played at Munster, they've 8 goals scored so far. So while we talk about the firepower that Ballyhale Shamrocks have with particularly their 4-star forwards, this Ballygunner team and Hutchinson particularly, even if they play like Limerick up till say their half forward line, there's a real feeling that they're going to go for goals, this Ballygunner team.
Yeah, and like even you take the third goal on Sunday, it was interesting. It was actually Ty Foley, the cornerback, had the initial shot that broke to Billy O'Kee. So that kind of shows in terms of, you know, bit Limerick-esque in terms of defenders coming out of defence, defenders coming upfield, providing that kind of different kind of attacking option. I guess on Sunday, the goals were kind of key in terms of the first one kind of set them up on their way, and then the ones in the third quarter basically, I suppose, kind of put the game to bed. I was down at the semi-final against Loughmore or Castellani before Christmas. I think the goals that day were very, very important in terms of, it was a bit, far more of a battle in terms of the conditions and the, I suppose, the quality of the opponents that put up to them and the test they posed that day. But the timing of their goals was very, very key to kind of set them apart from Kevin and Mikey Manny. And it just... you know, it definitely is a trade with them. I think you would have seen it in the Waterford County final as well. An early goal kind of set them on their way. And, you know, it's definitely, you know, the stakes are going to be raised now in terms of the quality of opposition that they're going to face. It's going to be a different kind of a test, I think, in the All-Ireland semi-final, not least the venue. I mean, that was a big thing on Sunday, having been at the last two Ballygunner games, that the quality of pitch surface was just poles apart. Obviously, look, it was just very, very difficult weather conditions the day in the Farrer Field in Dungarvan for the semi-final, and it made it a bit of a dogfight. But the quality of the Páirc Uí surface on Sunday definitely aided Ballygunner. And I think we've seen that maybe in football as well, and actually in hurling as well, as well as Ballyhale, getting to play that Leinster final in Croke Park. The use of probably the two best pitches in the country at the moment at this time of year for club finals has been great, and definitely Ballygunner, you know, was to their advantage. When you compare it to maybe, I suppose, the difficulties they had the last time they were in Cork for a Munster final against Barnsley a couple of years ago, which was a bit of a mud bat in Páirc Uí for that game.
Yeah, it's amazing what a difference those good surfaces have made, particularly at some of the football games we've seen over the last couple of weeks. Are we kind of getting slightly ahead of ourselves, where many hurling fans are getting excited, Fintan, about the idea of Ballygunner and Ballyhale meeting in an All-Ireland final next month? I mean, there's obviously two semi-finals that still have to be navigated, but in theory, that would be one hell of an All-Ireland final.
Yeah, look, it's an actual thing for neutrals to look at, because I suppose they both... you know, they kind of have the star names in terms of Waterford and Kilkenny hurlers, and they would have played in an All-Ireland semi-final in 2019. That was really only decided by an own Cody goal was the big thing that day in Thurles. But yeah, you're right. I think both of them are going to get tested in different ways now in their semi-finals. I mean, the thing about Shocknail is that, well, they haven't won an All-Ireland semi-final. They've continuously proven that how much they kind of test teams. Obviously, people talk about the Ballyhale game in Newry, which would have been January 2020 now. But like, remember a couple of years ago,
giving Piercy a right good go as well.
Exactly. Yeah, that's the game to kind of forewarn Ballygunner, because like, you're going to Parnell Park. It's the exact same situation. I mean, you know, Parnell Park is a tighter pitch. It's going to be a different type of a sod. That's going to be a far different type of a test, I think, of Ballygunner's capabilities than maybe Sunday was in kind of a wider open Páirc Uí Caoimh. I think it's fair to expect, or it's at the moment, I suppose, if you're to predict it, to a Ballygunner Ballyhale final. But at the same time, both Shocknail and St Thomas are kind of proven county champions in their own right. They're experienced teams in the All Ireland series. Obviously, Thomas has won an All Ireland, some of their players, and they've got to a final. Shocknail, regular competitors, are hurling and football at this level. So I don't think there's a sense that Ballygunner and Ballyhale are going to take it for granted. But I think it's natural to kind of put them both as favourites just because of the level of displays that they served up in their provincial finals. You know, both of them probably had their scares in their semis, if you look at it. You know, Ballyhale against St Ryan is a Ballygunner against Loughmore. And it seems like that once they kind of got over that hard test, they both just absolutely cut loose in their respective provincial finals then.
Thanks a million, Fintan, for joining us on the Club Championship Show.
No worries, Will.
We shall now take a look back, Killian, at the games that took place last weekend, the two camogie finals, because these were repeats of the 2019 deciders, and in the end it was the two beaten teams who came out on top in both of the finals. We start maybe with the intermediate game on Saturday at Semple Stadium. We were talking last week with Darrow Corr about Kay Kenny, and in the end of that one goal and 11 points of St Rhinus that you see up on the graphic at the moment where they beat Galtier, 111 to 10 points, she scored 9 points of the total during the game, including one of the most exquisite points that you'll see all year, where she was over effectively on the sideline on her weaker side towards the end of the game. I think there was about 2 minutes left, and it flies right over the black spot to, at that stage, put St Rhinus 3 points up, and Ray Daly got a late point to just secure it at the end. Kay Kenny had a huge game once again, the young jewel star from Offaly.
Yeah, absolutely. But you know, and I know long enough around the Midlands now that Kay Kenny's name has been out there for the last number of years, Will. And you know, we've seen the flashes of her brilliance both at ladies football and camogie, but I think there's a maturity coming to Kate's game now, you know, that she's probably now being looked at as a leader maybe among that group. And you know, what a leadership role to turn up on the biggest day, and you know, down at Temple Stadium, For a lot of people, the home of hurling, to turn up with a performance like that, we know of her undoubted talent. It was great to show then that talent on the top tier. But, you know, I just think Reina's and ultimately then Raharney, you know, from what was 2 years ago, you know, a little bit of hurt and so forth having been taken from that. And, I think they brought that with them, although they probably weren't going to publicly admit it, because now at this stage, you know, you'd be talking about bringing hurt that something was 2 years old. There's a lot of maturity in both of the teams, and I think that was a big factor. And you've also got the comment, Will, about the size of their panels and so forth, that I think that played a big factor as well. And not saying that Galtier would be short of them either. I just think Galtier lost a couple of their main leaders in the last 18 months, and they'll be a team that'll be coming again. There's no question about that, and they could be knocking around in the next few weeks as well. I just thought Reina's, there was a steeliness about them, Will. And I know Galtier, they had a goal opportunity themselves as well. Mm. But just Kate Kenny's performance was fantastic.
Yeah, I think on the commentary it was compared to Nicky Quaid's save, the save that Alan Gilligan made towards the end, where it looked like Galtier, with a few attackers coming in around the ball, it was at their mercy to score a goal, which could well have sent the game at that stage to extra time. But a brilliant save from Alan Gilligan, which really at that stage, it's amazing what a difference it can make if a team is 3 points down and just needs that goal to get back into it. What a kind of shift in momentum within a game it can be when a chance like that is missed.
Oh yeah, absolutely, and it was seen in the other game as well. You know that goal opportunities when they arrive, they have to be taken, and especially in winter hurling. You know, I definitely do think that as Fintan alluded to there, I think game of Ballygunner and Kilmallock had been played maybe in a different venue, it might have had a whole different kind of feel about it. But the surface in Parkyqueeve had seen an awful lot of traffic in recent months, but it's still upheld, and that affected the quality of the game. And I think Semple Stadium alluded to the quality of the intermediate encounter on Saturday. But as I talk about momentum switches, then an opportunity not taken, where Ryan has took effectively every opportunity that came their way, and that was the kind of fall through then to the result ultimately at the end.
Yeah, and you were at Temple Tui on Sunday for the game between Raharney and Clonmorris. We kind of touched on the top of the show. Remarkably, the Clonmorris were able to just keep trucking despite their lack of players that were available to them this year. They kept going despite Hannah Corr getting the goal in the game. The only thing for Clonmorris, I think, when they look back in Killian, was a goal chance that they missed, which looked absolutely gilt-edged when their full forward found herself in behind the Raharney defence. And somehow the Raharney goalkeeper came out and made the save.
Yeah, there's no question about it. And Jackie Horgan got through there 1-1. It was a lovely ball inside, and you would think, anywhere else, and this ball was in the back of the net. But you'd have to credit Anna Weir, probably the experience now that she's garnering, playing in these games, but also, representing Westmeath as well. I just thought very, very impressive in goal. She made an unbelievable save at the end of the game as well. Might have been caught first time on the commentary, but when we watch back the replay for the shot that Patrice Diggan had, Anna Weir staking up strong within a crowd of players. But that one at the time, Will, Clonmorris had kind of started to turn the screw a little bit. Raharney had got off to a fantastic start with a great Hannah Corr goal. They led by a goal and a point to no score. And then all of a sudden, Clonmorris kind of went into a groove that they fought the game on their terms, and Raharney were probably guilty of slipping into that. And Clonmorris got back and were, trailing within a point coming up towards the break. And all of a sudden, this ball breaks inside. And credit Anna Weir, I think it was actually her ankle that might have, deflected out the ball in the end. But great credit to her. She stood up big and strong against Jackie Horgan. I still think Jackie, if she had an opportunity again, she might have had actually too much time on her hands.
Might have tried to go around the goalkeeper if she went back and had a chance at it again.
Yeah, exactly. Or even, if you had little time, you probably would have just pulled on it, and often enough it might have went to either one of the corners. I think she had too much time to think about it, and Anna got out on top and kind of, smothered it ultimately. But as you mentioned there, momentum swing, all of a sudden that goes wide, and Raharney are going in leading at half time rather than maybe being behind.
You said to Pádraig Connaughton afterwards on the match coverage on the Camogie YouTube that the crazy thing about this story now is nobody is promoted, because Galtier and Clonmorris would have had to win to go up to the next level. So they'll still be at intermediate and junior for the year coming. That also means that people had to look at the fixtures list already. Potentially, Raharney and Clonmorris could meet again in 3 weeks' time in an All-Ireland semi-final if they win their respective provincial championships, where they're both back out playing this weekend.
Yeah, look, it's just the anomaly, I suppose, of the situation. I actually think it's great for the competition that the 2020 championships were completed. But you know, we have a scenario now where if you're Rhinus or you're Raharney, you're thinking, here, hold on, we keep this show on the road. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm sure they had their celebrations, but they're probably back at it now, you know, last night or probably even tonight, and getting their heads focused for the weekend. And because, you know, they're there to be shot at now a little bit, Will. You know, you could see a story then next Monday. We're talking about how the All-Ireland champions were dethroned within a week or something like that. I'm sure they either Raharney or Rhinus want that to happen to them. You know, Clanmorris will obviously sniff an opportunity to get back there. They'll have their players registered. They'll have a stronger panel. They won't have to be calling on Liz Houlihan, who hopefully and thankfully safely will be able to have her baby in peace now in some ways. But, you know, there is an opportunity they could challenge each other again. I fully expect Rhinus and Raharney, I think the bits between the teeth, they could very quickly now find themselves upper grades again if they were to put back-to-back championships. And an unbelievable story, Will, to think that you could be up at the senior intermediate grade within 6 weeks of winning two All-Ireland titles.
It is incredible. We'll be talking again about the All-Ireland series at the start of next month. Now, a remarkable end to the Connacht Club Senior Football Championship final at Ballina on Sunday lunchtime. Pádraic Pearses, who won their first Roscommon Championship just a couple of years ago, got to the Connacht final that year but were beaten by Cara Finn. They were back in the Connacht final 2 days ago and they overcame Knockmore in the end by 113 to 1-11. Here are the final stages of the game as called on Shannonside FM by Willie Hegarty.
113 to 111. All eyes on James Malloy. The Pearses are on the brink. We've gone over the 3 minutes. We've played an extra minute. They never won a championship since 2019. They've won two. They have now won Connacht. Pádraic Pearses are the Connacht Club champions. They have defeated Knockmore. It's Pádraic Pearses against Kilmacud Crokes of Dublin in the All-Ireland Club semi-final. They have come to the home of Knockmore. They have come to Ballina. They have climbed Kilpatrick. They have climbed the summit mountain in Connacht. Pádraic Pearses 113. Knockmore 1-11. The Santa Claus hats are out. Christmas has come again. 2 weeks later, Thursday was Little Christmas for the women of Ireland. The women of the world, the 9th of January is for the men of Pádraic Pearses. It's their big Christmas, Noel. They have climbed the mountain. The Roscommon Club champions are the Connacht Club champions.
I always love, Killian, the understated joy that we get from local commentaries when a game like that takes place. But, well, again, what a story, you know. Pádraic Pearses is a team who, Pat Flanagan, who's had so much success across different counties, you know, multiple club titles with his own club, Clara, in Offaly, with Tyrrell's Pass in Westmeath. And here he is now bringing Pádraic Pearses to a Connacht title, which is a remarkable achievement, really.
Absolutely, and I have to say, I think Pat being a little bit unlucky with managing Westmeath and Offaly. I think, you know, if the cookie had crumbled a few different ways, Pat might have had a Leinster title or something for one of those over the years. But look, he obviously has something, Pat, there's no question about it. You talk to the Pearses guys, they're full of praise for him, so you know, he worked the oracle. But yeah, just back to Willie there for a second. I think he used every line in the book. It's a fantastic commentary, and Willie has obviously been one of the great ones of local radio over the years. A cracking piece there to finish it off. I got to see Pearses twice this year, Will. I happened just to be down in the family connections down in Johnstown watching Clydale and obviously Parish Derby and everything like that. I got to see him in the group stages, and they wouldn't have stood out as being, you know, absolutely fantastic. Now, I know that there was big changes between that then and when they played Clonagale in the Roscommon final, but you know, you felt obviously, Pat, COVID issues, there was I think one or two during the summer in that campaign, you know, that they probably had to come out and express themselves a little bit more, because they could have been guilty that you would have felt that they were going to be a defensive team. And I have to say, when I saw the two teams that qualified for Connacht, I was worried about the quality that we're going to have. But Pearses just seemed to all of a sudden change tact, and you know, maybe more were expecting something different from them and stood off them a little bit. And you know, once I think Pearses got ahead, it was going to be hard for Knockmore to get back. And I know, okay, they got close, but I don't think once Pearses were ahead and the same thing happened in the Roscommon final, they got a couple of lucky goal efforts, if they don't mind me saying so, in the Roscommon final, when maybe Clonagale were getting back at them at one stage, and ultimately, you know, they just had a bit between the teeth. They weren't going to be beaten, and I think Knockmore would have found it very, very hard to get out of Ballina with the victory once Pádraig Pearce has had the lead. But you know, great credit Paul Carey. What a kind of final to
8 points. He was right the Rovers. Yeah. Everything he kicked went over.
Absolutely. You know, like, again, wouldn't have been a standout character that, you know, to some extent with Pearce's in the couple of games that I had seen of them for Pearce's. But definitely, you know, come at the hour, come at the man. You stood up on the big occasion, a bit like Kate Kelly, you know, for Rhinus. You know, it's on the big occasions you want to be stepping up. In fairness, Paul did. And, you know, fair play to Darcy as well. Got the goal and had the standing goal as well.
Just before we look forward to the Ulster and Munster finals, Killian, Croke Park on Saturday, Nace will be bitterly disappointed where it seemed like there was an opportunity there for them. Paul Mannion out, he's had knee surgery, remains to be seen when he's going to come back. At halftime, they're right in the game. But then second half, Kilmacud Crokes, I thought defensively, were incredible. Kept Nace without a score, didn't give away free chances for Eamon Callaghan to put them over the bar. And in the end, that proved the difference between the sides. Kilmacud were able to share around the scoring load without Paul Mannion and were able to put that door fully bolted up in front of Nace and came to what was a pretty comfortable 7-point victory in the end.
Yeah, and you know what, Will? It could have been more if they had taken some of their goal chances, because Nace realistically didn't take a lot of theirs. So, you know, I don't think created too many of them either. You know, Nace were very good the first half. Probably, I thought, a little bit unlucky not to go in actually leading at halftime, troubled Kilmacud under kickouts and whatever. And then it was absolutely the absolute flip in the second half. They started Kilmacud to put extreme pressure on young Jack Rogers' kickouts. And, you know, he's only 18 years of age. He's doing his leaving cert in CBS, at the, you know, prepping for that now in the next couple of weeks. And maybe just, you know, youthful scenario. He panicked, I think, on the one or two occasions. And Kilmacud just started getting a belief then, and the score started to flow, and I think Nace were starting to hemorrhage that little bit. Jack Cleary was struggling then to kind of get on the ball in the middle of the field. But, you know, the loss of Kerwin was obviously a bigger loss for Nace than Paul Mannion was for Kilmacud, because, you know, some of the other Kilmacud players stood up. I do think if Nace look at it back, you know, there was a few players didn't get into the groove of the game at all. And, you know, once Eamon Callaghan was tied up in that second half, it was very, very hard to see where Nace were going to pop up with scores. I'm not saying Kerwin would have made the 7 points of a difference, but I do think that, you know, he would have been busy enough to keep two players occupied for Kilmacud that probably would have freed up some of the others on the Nace team. But great credit to Kilmacud. You know, it's not all about Paul Mannion. There's guys there that are well able to lead. And, you know, I suppose, have to give mention to Craig Diaz, I think, in the middle of the field. I thought he had a stormer of a second half, and a veteran now, nearly, I suppose, of that team, but really showed great leadership in that second half.
He really did, yeah. Rory O'Carroll leading from the back, but leading from the front in many ways during the game as well. Killian, I know duty calls for you in school in the next few minutes, so thanks a million for joining us on the Club Championship show this morning.
You're welcome. We'll talk to you soon.
We've got Cahair O'Kane with us as well, because we're looking forward to two provincial finals this weekend. So one side is complete in the All-Ireland Championship. We know that it's going to be Pádraig Pearce is up against Kilmacud Crokes in a few weeks' time. We'll find out the other side of the draw this weekend when the Ulster and Munster finals come to a close. And Cahair, at the start of the campaign, we were looking forward to the quarterfinals in Ulster at the time, and you were pretty sweet on the idea of Kilcoo going back to the final again. They were tested the last time out against Glen, but I think they've had a pretty impressive run through the province so far heading into this final against Derrygonley Harps at the weekend.
They have. I'd love to claim great credit for pulling something out of my hat there, but I just felt that Kilcoo were been underestimated by a lot of people, given that they were still the reigning Ulster Club champions at that time. They have had an impressive run, to be fair. I think they probably stood out against Ramor United, really, the first night that they played. I think people sort of sat up a wee bit and took notice again. They really cut across the dry ground and Breffni that night and tore Ramor apart a wee bit. And since then, you know, the Glen game, Glen were being talked up, obviously. They'd been made All-Ireland favourites, joint All-Ireland favourites, as soon as they'd come out of Derry. And that sort of Kilcoo down to the ground, really. You know, aside with the experience and the willingness to get annoyed by something like that, that game was just perfectly set up. They had all the natural strengths and attributes that suited a team like Glen. They looked at how Glen had struggled against the Unions in the preliminary round, and and basically laid a similar template, only better. Kilcoo are very, very, very good on the break, and that's the difference between them and most teams. You know, anybody can put 15 men behind the ball. I suppose it's what you do when you get it, and that's one thing that Kilcoo are very good at. They have pace, they have serious pace all over the pitch, and they will run teams ragged. And that is probably where the challenge lies for Derry Gonley. A, in breaking them down, and B, in being resolute enough themselves that they don't overcommit. I think it can be a very cagey game. I think Derry Gonley will be very, very wary of overcommitting and leaving the spaces that Kilcoo's pace could harm them in. And for that reason, I think you're probably going to get a lot of back and forward. You're not going to get an awful lot of scores, and I don't think there's going to be an awful pile in it.
That's why, you know, I enjoy this time of year, because watching Pádraig Pearse's against Knockmore last weekend, they're a team who play a lot of kick passes and play the ball in quite long, while you look at Kilcoo, very different style. They like to work the ball through the hands, but they've got a very kind of joined up transitional system with how they work the ball. It's almost like this Kilcoo team almost encourages you to attack them so that you'll be out of position when they turn the ball over.
Absolutely, that's what they thrive on. They thrive on turnovers, sort of much like a lot of the best inter-county teams at the minute. They thrive off that turnover, and they're really hitting you hard then on the break when they go. And that's maybe just where they hold a wee edge over Derry Gonley. Derry Gonley are more of a kicking team, absolutely, more direct, bigger physically. And you know, for anybody that needs, you know, a hint that there might be a shock on the cards, the Ulster semi-final when Kilcoo won it 2 years ago, like, you know, Kilcoo were very, very lucky to get out of that game. Derry Gonley had them really, really worried and really rattled. Now, I would say that Kilcoo weren't at their best that day, but then that's a running theme for Derry Gonley, where no matter what they kind of do, people, you know, talk them down for whatever reason, and it's always about the opposition weren't great or somebody didn't play well. And
but if that happens, you know, consistently, that shows a skill in a team and being able to stop an opposition, doesn't it?
Exactly. You know, Derry Gonley haven't got enough credit for their wins in terms of making the opposition play poorly. That's, you know, that's the bottom line for them. The only thing I would fear for them is that their strengths are their strengths. They are a direct team. They're a physical team. I think Kilcoo will be very well set up for them. And Kilcoo have the experience of that game 2 years ago. They'll know Derry Gonley quite well from that. And just the fact that, you know, Conal Jones has caused a fair wee bit of bother at full forward for Derry Gonley all year. They're very strong in the middle, but they do like to play off them. They're not a team that is going to cut you in bits with their runners all the time, the way Kilcoo might. They're looking for the direct ball. They're looking to get it inside. And then, you know, when Ryan McAvoy, Kilcoo have a fullback who's perfectly suited for that, they will probably play Niall McAvoy right in front of him. They'll probably go back to the template that won them the Ulster final 2 years ago when they were playing a Glenties team that was, you know, similar in their setup in terms of, you know, they were even more direct. They were very, very direct. Everything on top of the goalkeeper. And Kilcoo were thoroughly prepared for that and dealt with that. It was tricky. It's not easy to deal with if the ball's right. But I just think that Kilcoo will know what's coming a wee bit. And they have the tools and the skill set to deal with it. And then it's where else did Derry Gonley get enough scores from to win the game?
Derry Gonley, well, this is new ground for them in many ways. It's also incredibly familiar because you mentioned 2 years ago, same opposition met in the semi-finals of the championship. This is a Derry Gonley team over the last 7-8 years have played regularly in Ulster. They've already beaten Tramore of Tyrone, who were on the back of their county team having won an All-Ireland title this year. They're a seasoned team within the province going into this final.
They are. I saw a thing shared on Twitter last night by the club, just to think it was probably their energetic PRO, Pádraig McGurn. But about, you know, he had written back in the, or I don't know if he had written it in the club's history in 2006, they had written about, you know, sort of feeling sorry for Enniskill and Gaels and not just getting over the line and a couple of goals that they'd had in Ulster. And wouldn't it be great if someday Derry Gonley could reach an Ulster club final? And, you know, this is a real dream for them. And to be fair to them, you know, they haven't gone away. They have kept coming back. As you say, it's their sixth go at it now, and they have improved with every single time they have come at Ulster, and they have been routinely written off. You know, and look, I'm as guilty as anybody. You know, I felt a couple of years ago that I felt that Trillick were in with a real good shot of winning Ulster when they came out of Tyrone. And sure enough, there you go, and they put them away in the first round down at Brewster Park and on a penalty shootout. And that's the kind of thing that, you know, as well, they probably thrive on that. You know, they do. They're used to the disrespect in one sense, and nobody likes being disrespected. But then at the same time, it is a fuel for them, and it's an easy fuel for them all the time. And there's no doubt that they'll have plenty of that fuel again this week, because everybody's going to assume that Kilcoo are going to walk out of Armagh on Sunday with the trophy. So, you know, this is it for Derry Gonley. Perhaps, you know, some of their, I think they have four or five fellas in their 30s now. You know, in terms of this team, this is probably the big chance, and you can be absolutely sure that they will want to leave absolutely nothing in that changing room on Sunday, and that's a real threat to Kilcoo.
I can see the newspaper clippings and the lettuce grounds on the door of the dressing room already for Derry Gonley Harps, given I think everyone, and myself included, think that Kilcoo are a team who are live contenders not just to win Ulster this year but also to win the All-Ireland Championship. I'm sure there'll be keen eyes in Ulster keeping an eye on this Munster final car at the weekend as well, which is intriguing. It's Cork against Kerry again. There's that tiny little bit of needle going into it, given that Stax wanted to flip a coin and have it either in Tralee or in Páirc Uí Chaoimh. Finbar has wanted a neutral venue, and as it works out, they're going to Semple Stadium on Sunday afternoon to play this final. You know, both teams are royalty within the province of Munster, and even royalty at an All-Ireland level, but it's been a while for success for both teams. Stack since 2014, and most of Finbar's best times have come a few decades ago. It is a very, very exciting looking final, though. Two free scoring teams going into this final too.
It is, and it's funny, you can see both sides' points on the coin toss 100%. Obviously, like, Austin Stacks were going to try and get the game into Tralee, and you can see why Finbars didn't want the toss. I think the manager said that, you know, there's no real advantage in Páirc Uí Chaoimh for us. We don't have a massive fan base. It's not really going to be feel like a home venue, so why give Stacks the advantage? Let's head for somewhere neutral. So I think they for their own chances, they probably did the right thing when it looked like, you know, no matter what way the coin toss went, they couldn't really win, but they might lose. So you can see why they've done that. Look, I've seen wee bits and pieces of them. I've watched a few clips and highlights over the last couple of days, and like, I'd seen Austin Stacks in a couple of the Kerry Championship games as well. Obviously, the game that was live on RT, St Brendan's semi-final, and you know what stands out to me is that I don't know that either of them are going to win the All-Ireland. I think there are stronger teams out there than both of them at the minute, but they're probably not a million miles off each other. I think Finbars look like a team that might be more suited to the All-Ireland stages at the minute. They have a wee bit more, I think they have a wee bit more cut and pace about them in attack. Obviously, Stephen Sherlock shooting the lights out, a full forward for them, and playing, you know, looks for somebody. I think he's 32, if I'm right in saying, like, and he has really been resurgent, and he looks so sharp and so fresh. And, you know, I say what highlights and bits I was able to find of them through the year, like, you know, deadly, absolutely deadly man. And it's a miracle sort of people don't know more about him, if you like, at the minute. So looking at it from afar now, I say I could never claim to be an expert on, well, anything, but definitely not on Munster club football. But looking at it from here, what I've seen of them, I like the cut of Finbars maybe a wee bit more than I just like the cut of Stacks at the minute.
We've had lots of drama with Stacks this year, including that penalty shootout and Kieran Donaghy kicking one of the best penalties I've ever seen. I didn't have Kieran Donaghy naturally down as a penalty taker. I'm not sure if that's because he's so tall and because I don't think I'd ever seen him take a penalty like that before, but clearly Stacks have been practicing them. Like, the standard of the penalties, because there's this kind of thing as well, Carb, that you hear the commentators say, oh, nobody wants to see a game decided by penalties. For me, a penalty shootout is a measure of skill. It's who can hold their nerve and who's got the best technique from 13 metres out and who can hold their nerve under pressure.
Look, we're on the same page in this one. I've been battering that for a while. Like, I don't understand the obsession with going back for replays and people saying, it's not fair. It's not a fair way to lose a game. It's nonsense. Somebody loses the replay as well. Somebody, you know, somebody stands up in the last minute of the game and kicks a 30-meter free wide, well, then, you know, what's the difference in that and missing the penalty? And arguably, at least in a penalty shootout, you know, all right, somebody misses the last penalty, but there might be two or three players that miss, and the blame is apportioned and shared, whereas somebody misses that last minute free. It's a wee bit of a nonsense. Now, I am all for penalty shootouts. I think we have to get the games finished. Replays are such a disaster for the fixtures that we can't afford. And you're right, like, penalties are absolutely a skill. And, you know, I very sort of badly took them for the club for years and was in nets trying to save them as well. I was rubbish at both. But they're a real skill set. Like, and I think there's maybe just clubs are maybe goalkeepers and teams are overthinking it a wee tiny bit. I have a real theory on penalties that, you know, when penalty takers aren't comfortable and aren't used to taking penalties, they're always going to go to their strong side. And if the goalkeeper goes to their strong side, 9 times out of 10, he's not going to be far away. So, but you don't, and that was the, you know, I think the Austin Stacks game proved that. Like, I think of the whatever 10 or 11 penalties, all but one went to the strong side. So that's what you're going to get. So if there's any goalkeepers looking at that, there you go.
There we go. That could be for this weekend if we've games going to penalties. Cara, you down as a Jordan Pickford who'd be able to both save them and score them during your time.
No.
Thanks a million once again for joining us on the Club Championship Show.
Thanks, Walt.
And the Club Championship Show here on OTB Sports is brought to you by AIB. Just a reminder of the fixtures which are coming up this weekend. Then both are on TG Cahair this Sunday. You've got the Ulster football final, Kilcoo, the champions of 2019, up against Derrygonley Harps. And then it's Cork against Kerry in the Munster football final at Semple Stadium. That game will pit Austin Stacks up against Finbars of Cork. Thanks a million for joining us on the Club Championship. We'll be back next Wednesday from 10:30 to look back on those two football provincial finals. And I look forward to the hurling semi-finals as well.
The Club Championship Show on OTB Sports in partnership with AIB, proud sponsors of the Football, Hurling and Camogie All-Ireland Club Championships. #TheToughest